Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Happy Wednesday, everybody. Welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. As always, I am Ken Reed, your TV Guidance Counselor, the show where someone picks an old TV guide from my vast collection. They write down what they would watch that week in history, they hand me the guide, they have their list, and we have a conversation about the difficult viewing choices of our collective past. A show that I enjoy doing. I do it every week, been doing it almost 4 years now. And one of the reasons I love doing the show so much is that it is a great opportunity for me to meet and talk to people whose work I've admired for years. And today is a great example of that. My guest is Josh Caterer, who you may know from the band The Smoking Popes. He is the singer, songwriter, frontman, guitarist, along with his brothers who are in that band. Also had a great band called Duval, which we talk about here. Easily one of my favorite bands, one of the most underrated bands of the 90s. If you don't, at a minimum, own Born to Quit, you're wrong. Everyone should own that record. It's coming up on the 20th anniversary of their record Destination Failure, and they'll be putting out a special edition vinyl LP soon, so absolutely buy that, but buy Born to Quit right now. Like, pause this show, you go to a record store, you buy it on your phone, buy Born to Quit, you must have that record. I also highly recommend the Duval record, All in Your Hands, one of my favorite songs ever. And Josh is a really smart, funny, charming guy. I had an amazing time talking to him. Could have talked to him for hours and hours more. Don't know if Josh would have put up with that, but he was very gracious, and I thank him for putting up with me talking about 1979 in television with him for the amount of time that I did on a little tour stop that they did here in Boston, Cambridge, actually. They played the Middle East on a Saturday matinee, and it was an excellent show. If they tour again, absolutely go see them. They are a fantastic live band, but like I said, buy their records. You will not be disappointed. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Josh Caterer of The Smoking Popes.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Josh Caterer, how are you, sir?
I am well.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me. I'm excited to partake in this excellent podcast.
You're very welcome. I'm excited to have you. Having just seen you guys play, excellent show. It was weirdly early in the day, which is kind of nice.
Yeah, we don't usually do the matinee shows.
Yeah.
But I kind of like it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's counterintuitive. You feel like rock and roll should happen at night.
True.
So biologically, there's an adjustment that needs to happen.
That's
but,
true.
But you know, we're done with our set.
It's daylight.
And it's daylight, and we can get on with our lives and do other things like eat food and talk about television shows.
Exactly. Yeah. Works out nicely. Were you a big? Were you going to like punk matinees and stuff when you were growing up? Like all ages shows.
Like matinee shows? No, I don't remember ever doing that.
Yeah, like I do. But now I want to do that again, but for different reasons. It's like you did it as a kid because you had to be home by a certain time.
Because now it's just like, you know, I'm too tired to stay up that
late.
I'd like to get everything done and be in bed by 9 if possible.
That's pretty much my world as well.
On the road, though, it's just not realistic.
No, absolutely not. The show doesn't even start till 9 sometimes,
right.
So you're
exactly
out there. So when I asked you about it, you said 1980 was the year you were looking at.
Somewhere around there.
So I gave you a stack. You gravitated towards one immediately from 79 because it had KRP on the cover.
Because it had WKRP on the cover, which is really one of my favorite TV shows of all time. Of any genre.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even say that it's just like my favorite sitcom of all time. It's like probably shortlist greatest television shows.
The writing is unbelievably good.
The casting of those characters, they're these kind of stereotype caricatures, but they were cast so well that the people embody those caricatures so perfectly. I have to wonder, I don't know, but I have to wonder if maybe they had cast certain actors and then built some of the characterization around them.
I think they did. They did like a pretty extensive rehearsal period and stuff. And if you watch the pilot, which is all about Gordon Jump's character, you see that they kind of realize what they have with the ensemble cast as the first season moves on, and then shift the focus a little bit, and the characters evolve a little bit. Because it was more like, you know, Venus Flytrap was like way too fly in that first episode, but now it becomes more of like a real person. Mm-hmm. And they sort of ground them as they kind of move
on. And wasn't Johnny Fever sort of really out of it at the beginning? Like, he was always falling asleep everywhere.
Yeah, it was like, he's on so many drugs.
Yeah, yeah. Which I don't think they ever said that he was on drugs, but clearly he was. But then as the show progressed, they realized that there was so much more that he could bring to the table, I'm assuming, that it was better to have him talking most of the time than it was to have him falling asleep.
It's that great ensemble workplace sitcom that ends up being more of a family sitcom than sometimes some family sitcoms.
Yeah.
Like Cheers and Mary Tyler Moore and those shows that just really, really got that dynamic well.
Yeah, yeah.
And one of the only shows that had like a pretty weirdly natural mixed race cast in like the late 70s, which even then you still didn't see that much.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I just rewatched the first season because I bought it on DVD and just sort of binge watched my way through it. And I noticed not only the diversity of the cast, but also in one of the episodes in the first season, they were dealing with Les was having this problem because people thought he was gay.
Yeah.
And he was like going to jump off of a ledge and kill himself because they thought. So they were addressing that. And I'm not sure how far that had progressed in the public consciousness. I'm assuming, you know, 1979.
It was still cartoonish.
It was still like, it would have been widely embraced that there was something wrong with being gay.
Yes.
And that people would have thought he was justified in wanting to kill himself for being thought of as gay.
We understand.
But the attitude that the show was taking was very progressive.
Yeah.
In, you know, they're reaching out to him on the ledge and saying, like, I don't even care.
Right. We just love you.
We just like love you. Even if you are gay, which, you know, you're supposed to assume he's not really gay.
Right, right.
But the cast of the show is saying, we're willing to love people even if they're gay, and we're not going to hold it against them. So that was very moving.
And that's a huge unusual message in the late 70s, too. And Barney Miller was similar in that they also had gay characters and characters that were like sex workers and like people who would normally be caricatured as like bad people on a cop show that were just like, they're just people and they have stuff going on, you know, and they always treated them like characters and treated them like people, which in some ways I'll watch those 70s shows now and they're almost more progressive than stuff that I see now because they're a little blunter about stuff sometimes. Yeah. But in some ways they also aren't, but it's a little bit shocking, like something like that in KRP. I bet when you saw that episode, you're like, oh, wow, I didn't expect this.
I didn't expect it. I hadn't seen it. It's been years since I'd seen the show, and I don't think I'd ever watched through, you know, sort of binge watched any of it. I just remember watching it when it was actually on TV, just watching the syndicated versions of it.
Did you ever see the new WKRP they did in the 80s?
No.
It was
Is it any good?
It's actually really, really good. It's French Stewart, who was on Third Rock from the Sun, plays this like crazy DJ, and it was actually really weirdly progressive. Like, they had a whole episode about Ice-T's Cop Killer.
Okay.
But like, because the station played it, and then it was like this like ripped from the headlines, but it was done in like a really interesting, smart, funny way, just like the original series.
I want to see that.
It's
so
good.
Bad.
It's good. And Hugh Wilson, who was one of the creators and writers, had a show called The Famous Teddy Z in the late 80s that was also one of the best sitcoms I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And it's all about Alex Rocco, who's like an old man agent, but they kind of Trojan horsed it by selling it as a show about John Cryer, and then after the first episode he's hardly in it.
Okay.
It's just a show about old men who are agents in Hollywood.
Yeah, well, that's great.
It's great.
That's great. It's I'm going to have to look at it.
Was that one of the ways that you would kind of hear new music too with things like WKRP? Because they were playing contemporary music. Like, they'd play The Clash in a couple episodes and stuff.
Well, let me see. I was born in 72. So, you know, I was like eight. sort of 7, 8, 9 yeah. when that show was on. And I wasn't, like, I was drawn to the sensibility of it. I already right. liked rock music. I don't think I got into punk music till I was like 11. So right. I was listening at that point to like Kiss, and there were episodes where they had a Kiss poster.
Oh yeah.
Like one of the first couple of episodes, you know, Travis came in and he like hung a Kiss poster up on the wall. And yeah. He's like, that's our new direction.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, cool. Kiss. Yeah. Kiss was like, those were the first, some of the first music I ever bought was Kiss Double Platinum on cassette from Kmart.
Yeah.
So I was like super into Kiss, and so I would have resonated with that, but I don't think I picked up on the Clash thing until later. I just knew, I knew that there was, you know, particularly something in Johnny Fever that like resonated with, you know, the kind of man that I wanted to grow up to, yeah. to be.
Well, it's kind of like subversive and kind of like anti-authoritarian mm-hmm. a little bit.
I knew that even when I was 8.
Yeah. No, I was the same way. Like, my dad was a Navy guy, and I remember him talking about the Navy, and I was just big. He'd be like, oh, and then we had to, when you cross the equator, you got to swim through the garbage thing. And I was like, why? He's like, well, you have to. And I'm like, well, what if you don't, though? He's like, what do you mean? I'm like, can't you just say, like, no, I'm not doing it? Like, I was like 7 or 8, and it was just like, oh, I think I have a different mindset than my father about some of these things.
Right.
He's like, no, they told you to do it. You have to do that.
And you have
like,
to do it.
Maybe
no,
you
I
don't.
Was like, I don't know. Even from when I was a kid, those sort of characters appealed to me. I liked Cheech and Chong.
Okay.
Even though I didn't, you know, I didn't understand. I eventually became very familiar with marijuana. But before I ever did, you know, right. at the age of 8, I just liked the idea of being a countercultural person who smoked a lot of pot.
Well, they were like Bugs Bunny. Like, yeah. almost like that. Like, I'm one step ahead of everybody, but I'm kind of like, hey.
Yeah.
I don't care, but I'm also smarter than you.
Exactly. Yeah. They seem smarter, even though, like, they're... Their sort of facade is that they're these doofuses, but really, you know that they have their finger on the pulse of reality more than the man does. And as far as cartoons, like comics, my favorite was Andy Capp. So I was always,
oh, really?
I guess, drawn towards substance abusers.
Blue-collar substance abusers.
I knew I was destined to become one eventually.
And it, but...
Which it's, turned out to be a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Well, yeah, but I mean also, but a lot of those characters were written very realistically in the way that the people who end up being substance abusers kind of have similar personality traits, too. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that probably, that could also drag you to that, too, where it was like, oh, that person seems to share sort of an emotional resonance with me for a lot of reasons.
Yeah, part of it is kind of the thing that's driving them to substance abuse is this intuitive... knowledge that the system is screwed, and there's something about reality that seems absurd. And
yeah, it's like an otherness, and they need to just kind of be like, I can't change it, so I'm just going to kind of zone out a little mm-hmm. bit.
Yeah, so but there's you're like transcending the system by
yeah.
by failing out of it.
Right, by your own hand, though.
By your own That's hand, on your like, own yep, terms. Yep,
yeah. I'm going to crash this plane myself if mm-hmm. it's going down, you know?
Yeah.
And yeah, that is something that appealed to it. And I think a lot of my friends and people I know who ended up being drawn to sort of punk rock stuff, it was a similar thing, you know?
Yep.
It was that was one of the things that led to it. And around that time in the early 80s, you started getting all this punk rock scare stuff like the Quincy Punks episode
okay.
and the Chips episode.
I have like a...
Good, which is insanely silly, and you know, it was. But I remember watching those and going, this seems awesome, but it was supposed to be like a scare thing, you know, like
right.
a juvenile delinquency thing.
You remember the Scum of the Earth episode?
Yes, yes, yes. Or even like, did you ever watch Dragnet?
Yeah, sometimes.
The that show's amazing because it shows this cultural shift between the 50s up to the 70s because it was on so long, and Jack Webb wrote and directed the final episode, which is 1969, mm-hmm. and you see L.A. change in that time, and it's an anti-hippie episode, and he just hates them so much, like he just, and it's about this hippie named Blue Boy who overdoses on LSD, mm-hmm. but it's such this crazy anti-youth episode written by a guy from two generations before who just hates them, and it's such a fascinating cultural relic to watch, and it's hilarious and
right.
dumb and
like unintentionally hilarious.
Oh yeah, it's fantastic. So one of the things you wrote here, one of the first things actually, is Mr. Rogers, which you're one of the first people to ever mention him on the show, and I'm shocked by that.
Oh, I would think more people would, especially because I noticed it was, the show was on at 6:30 p.m.
Yeah.
Obviously, he's going to be on in the morning, but
they'd re-air him frequently.
Somehow, there's a market for Mr. Rogers viewing at 6:30 p.m.
I think it's the mommy and daddy want a half hour to themselves. You mm-hmm. watch this kind of thing.
Yeah.
But that show was, I did a mini episode about him once called Mr. Rogers versus the KKK. Because
yeah.
he actually sued the KKK and won.
He did?
Yeah, I'd never heard this story before, and I was looking through a TV guide, and they had a little article about it.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, what is this? So I researched it. And there was a KKK faction in the South that were going to schools and handing out these cards to kids that had a phone number on it. And when they called, it was a recording of a guy pretending to be Mr. Rogers, saying all these horrifically racist stuff. And he got wind of it, and he sued them. And he
won.
He basically shut down that wing of the KKK financially.
Good.
And it was amazing because he was just like, I don't mind parody. And stuff. This was cruel, and this was using my name and the relationship of cultivated with children for evil.
Yeah.
And he had such an insightful, interesting things to mm-hmm. say about it. And there's footage I found from around that time when he was on the David Letterman show. And Letterman, who I liked, but he had a tendency that I hated, where he would have people on who he kind of looked down on as like a kook, and mm-hmm. he would try to just like dump on them the whole time.
Yeah.
And he's trying to take that angle with Mr. Rogers, and he's not taking the bait, and he ends up completely disarming him.
Oh,
and
I would like to see that.
It's great. It's on YouTube, because there, it's around,
you know, that's an interesting dynamic that you're talking about, because in probably, you know, 99 out of 100 cases, when David Letterman did that to somebody, it's because Letterman was picking up on something accurate, that this was an actual nutcase.
Yeah. But, or a con man or whatever.
Yeah, something that could be exposed.
Yeah.
But in the case of Mr. Rogers, this is fascinating, is that he does seem to be that way. Like, his first impression that he would give you is that there's something amiss there.
Yeah.
Or creepy or something.
Yeah,
people
he's
like
so
to make
slow
fun of him.
And measured.
Yeah. But it's like the more you dig, the more you discover this treasure of just beauty, just a beautiful soul.
Yeah, he's like the most humane person ever.
I don't know about you, but I can see kind of like these cycles in my relationship with him as a broadcaster, where it started out when I was a kid. I watched his program a lot, just without any sort of judgment.
Yep.
He was just a sort of presence in my life, just like Sesame Street and the Electric Company.
He's a nice guy, and I like to sit and watch him talk about crayons.
I didn't really think about whether he was creepy or not.
Yep.
I just sort of liked the show. And then grew up a little bit, stopped watching it, and then sort of late teens, early 20s, would revisit the show ironically.
Yep.
And feel that there was something to be made fun of.
Mr. McFeely.
Yeah. How his songs came across kind of silly.
Yeah.
I would listen to Everybody's Fancy, Everybody's Fine, and kind of, you know, point out the ironic creepiness of it or something.
Yeah.
But as that progressed in my adult life, it's sort of like the more you revisit his stuff, the deeper you dig into what he's doing, the more it genuinely grabs your heart and moves you, and you see that it is all motivated by these impulses that are more pure and more selfless than most of what you're seeing in the world today.
Absolutely, and so sincere.
And so sincere.
So sincere. And that, I can't even think of before or after anyone who was that brave to mm-hmm. be that sincere on television. And he got dumped on and dumped on and dumped on so much for it, and it didn't bother him.
Yeah.
And that was the amazing thing. So like Letterman starts talking about Mr. Robinson's Neighbor, the Eddie Murphy thing,
mm-hmm.
being like, I bet he's going to hate this. And Rogers is like, actually, I really enjoy it because it's coming from a place of love. And I went to 30 Rock before the show and I visited him mm-hmm. to thank him because I thought it was a nice twist on it that was his experience. And Letterman's like, like he just doesn't even know what to do with that. And there's an amazing footage of Fred Rogers testifying before Congress.
I've seen that.
It's incredible. Makes me cry. Yeah. And the way he turns that, like, cartoonish Southern senator who goes, well, I'm supposed to be a kind of a tough guy, Rogers.
Yeah.
He goes this whole thing, and it's just from purely being totally sincere about it.
It's beautiful.
And I think that one of the reasons that we probably thought it was stupid and creepy when we were teenagers and in our 20s was partly because we're probably cynical jerks, like everyone is at that age. Not to lump you into that group, I'm just assuming. But also because it's so tailored directly to speak to children. Mm-hmm. That we're not, that's when you're most out of that mindset at that age, because you're trying to be an adult really hard. And when you get older, you can kind of realize that it's okay to embrace that stuff again. So it's almost like some sort of weird evolutionary thing. You're like, children's things, no.
Yeah. Well, you know, what is it that they say that the human brain isn't fully developed until you're like 25,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So I think there's some phase that you're going through in your late teens and early 20s, where your brain possibly is at a point in its development where the part where you think everything is ironic all the time, and you have a sense of superiority about how stupid you think everything is, that sort of dominates your thinking. And it's not until you get past that into your late 20s and your 30s where you can start to have a more accurate sense of discernment about what's happening.
Right.
And sense you're of getting self. Over, these sort of crippling kinds of self-consciousness that are driving you to snicker at everything all the time.
It's almost like your brain makes you go way over the top with that so that when it lands back down, you can like normalize.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, here's all your insecurities and you're afraid of everything as a kid. Now go way crazy that nothing matters, and then it kind of evens out.
I don't think I really started to enjoy life until I was about 30.
Yeah, I agree. That's when I stopped having like panic attacks all the time. And that, part of it too is I think you've been through life experiences where you go, oh, things work out usually. Or like, you know, I'm not going to die right here. And that helps as well. And everything's a big deal when you're younger. Like, everything's the end of the world.
Yep.
And stuff, when I watch stuff like Fred Rogers, like actually when I was down in New York a couple weeks ago, which if you have time when you're down there, I recommend going to the Museum of the Moving Image in Astoria, Queens. They have a Jim Henson exhibit, and it's all of his notes and original puppets and the Rolf and the Sesame Street puppets.
Oh,
and
wow.
When I walked in, I just instantly started to well up like a crazy person. But it totally caught me off guard.
What's it called? The Museum of...
The Moving Image.
Of the Moving Image.
It's right in Astoria, Queens. And it's like $10 to get in. And the whole second floor is a vintage arcade. But they have this amazing Henson exhibit. And he's a guy that I put in that category with Mr. Rogers, where they were kind but subversive and kind of angry about the cynical way the world was turning. And like... Henson came out of that like Manson hippie fit, like he was like that like era of like you're ruining everything, and that's through all his work when you look at it. But in a way that the way I sum it up is, I think Mr. Rogers and Jim Henson made a generation of us better people.
I think that
and
feel
not
that way,
not in an overt like sappy like cheesy way. It was just in like a natural, almost you didn't even notice way.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes me sad when I don't see that in the entertainment world anymore. Or even if I don't even know if you could do that anymore, because they had a platform that was so small.
Right.
A big platform because there was so much fewer things. And it's.
Yeah, I mean, is there anything that has that tone to it happening now?
Not that I've seen. And not that everybody watched that show.
Mm-hmm.
At some point, everybody watched Mr. Rogers. And there's nothing, you know, even when I watch PBS stuff now, there's nothing that has that tone. It's much more kinetic, and it doesn't have that, like, sort of measured, almost meditative kids thing, you know?
Yeah.
And it was like, let's focus for a half hour.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, Michael Keaton got his start on that show, and George Romero got his start on that show.
Wow.
Because it was made in Pittsburgh, and it was, like, the big thing in Pittsburgh, and all these people started there, and it's...
Yeah.
Love it, yeah. And that the thing with the KKK is amazing, just how he's like, no, I'm not taking this. I'm not putting up with this. Nope.
I wouldn't want to tangle with Mr. Rogers.
No, and he knew copyright law really well, and that's what he got them on. Because they tried to say it was parody, and he was like, he like poured through legal books and was like, nope, and just like took them down. It's great. And then the Brady Bunch is, for a generation, that's the show, I think.
Yeah.
That's the shared experience show.
Yeah, it was. I think I was, I don't know. I feel like I didn't necessarily have like a crush. I know a lot of people maybe were driven by some sort of like a crush on Marsha or Jan.
Yeah. Oh, Jan, really?
Well, yeah.
She's blonde. She's pretty. She's Jan.
Right. But I feel like there was just something about the world. When I think back on that show, I feel like their house was like this colorful world that was just kind of a good place to be.
Yeah.
Like a lot of those shows, looking back on them, there's something about the set and the way that the music plays into it and the tone of the writing that just... It makes you feel a certain way that
yeah.
that's a world that you'd want to live in, and you might not even be fully conscious of why,
right?
Or be remembering any particular storylines or
it's just comfortable.
Agenda that the show might have, or like you know Brady Bunch being about blended family and
right.
things like that. But I never picked up on that. I just sort of would be like, oh, that would be a fun place to live with
yeah.
all those characters.
That stairs is cool, and Alice seems fun, and mm-hmm. yeah. Yeah, totally. I mean, it was, you know, plus it was the first show, along with Gilligan's Island, that hit that strip show syndication every day after school or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That was like, everybody just watched it. It was on, and you yep. saw the episodes over and over and over again. Plus, yeah. I mean, Vincent Price was on it, so you can't go wrong with
Vincent
that.
Vincent Price was on it, Davy Jones.
Yep.
So which girl. Connected to being a fan of the Monkees.
Yes. The Monkees was that anarchy thing to me. Mm-hmm. That was that thing where it was like, these guys are all kind of above everything. And
yes.
I had Mickey Dolenz on, which
you
was
did?
Amazing. Yeah, it was great because he went into directing stuff later and producing uh-huh. and hearing like about the behind-the-scenes stuff and how they were trying to do something that was like Hard Day's Night, but no, you know, no one was doing anything like that in the 60s on TV.
Right.
And hearing that all my hopes of what they were thinking when they made it were actually what they were doing
yeah.
was kind of amazing. The Monkees, and I loved The Young Ones in the 80s as well. That was like the show that changed my life.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I had horrible insomnia as a kid, and I slept like 2 hours a night, but I would just watch TV okay. all night. And MTV used to air The Monkees and The Young Ones back to back, which makes perfect, is like kind of a perfect thing,
it
which
does.
I think would
it's
just
like
happenstance.
Two generations of the same... middle finger to the
yeah.
establishment.
Yeah, and both those shows, I was like, this is nuts in this world. I don't know what's going to happen, and I love it. Mm-hmm. And I saw The Damned on The Young
right.
Ones.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't know what this is, but there's a vampire playing a punk song, I guess, and I love it. This is mm-hmm. everything I love now.
yeah.
And it was like that moment where you see the thing you always liked and you didn't know it.
Yeah.
So I always link the Monkees with that. And there was a new Monkees as well, if you remember, in 87.
Oh, I remember hearing about that, but I didn't actually ever see it.
It's more like The Young Ones than The Monkees, and it's
okay.
interesting. It's they did one record that's actually pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like this kind of lost LA power pop record
yeah.
that has some good songs on it, and just but the backlash of it not having anything to do with the real Monkees was just too much. Like people were like, I'm not
okay.
doing it.
So who wrote the songs? Was it?
It wasn't the band. They just hired songwriters,
okay.
Much like the Monkees.
Right.
And
although Nesmith wrote some stuff.
He did get some of his stuff and like listened to the band, and but that was, I mean, he got into it with Don Kirshner about that,
mm-hmm.
and has that famous quote where he punched a hole in the wall. Have you ever heard that story?
No.
So Nesmith quit, and he punched a hole in the wall right next to Don Kirshner's head, and
mm-hmm.
said, that should have been your effing face, and then just quit. And everyone's like, oh, well, he could quit because his mom was rich and stuff. But his mom didn't invent liquid paper for like 4 more years. And the Monkees in his contract, if he quit, he had to pay them back what they
Ooh,
paid him. So
that's
they
a bad contract.
Oh, it's a terrible contract. They wrote it in as a prepayment, basically, for like whatever mm-hmm. X money years. So he was destitute. He lived on a beach for like 3 years.
Wow.
And I
love
this
stuff.
He's
like, Mom, you
yeah.
got to invent something.
Please invent something to fix mistakes. All kinds of mistakes. And yeah, I love his music. And like, have you ever seen Elephant Parts that he did?
Yeah, I do remember that.
That's such a great, weird, just bizarre thing.
Yep.
And then he produced Repo Man.
Produced Repo Man.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was a cool guy. He just had great sensibility about things.
Yeah. And
he looked good in a stocking cap.
He certainly did.
Pioneered the stocking cap with the
fuzzy ball on top. One of my favorite jokes on the Monkees is they're like trying to sneak into a hotel, mm-hmm. and they're all dressed up, and he still has the hat on. Yeah. And Mickey Dolenz is like, "You don't know who this guy is?" And they're like, "No." And he goes, "You heard of Wool Hats?" And they're like, "Yeah." They go, "That's him." I'm like, what? He goes, "That's W.H. Wool Hat. He invented the wool hat." It's such a dumb, like, vaudeville style joke, yeah. But it's so weird and great.
Oh, I love it.
Mary Tyler Moore, the classic Midwest show.
Yeah, it is. And it's another case that's similar to WKRP, where the characters are all these kind of different compartmentalized caricatures,
mm-hmm.
but they're also, they're so comfortable in their own skin in being those characters.
Yeah.
Like Ted Knight, there's just nobody like Ted Knight.
Yeah.
Right, so he is a caricature, but at that time he was a caricature of no one. It was because he invented his own cartoon character that he was.
Yeah.
And now you can say there's like a Ted Knight type.
Yeah.
But that was him. That was just him.
Did you ever watch the Super Friends as a kid?
No.
Oh, the you know, Superman, Batman cartoon with the whole DC characters? Oh,
okay.
Ted Knight, uncredited, was the narrator, where he was like, "Oh, Super Friends, coming up." Like, and when I found that out, I was like, of course he was, and you can tell later.
Oh.
But I always had this affinity to him on Mary Tyler Moore, and I wonder, because it was like I subconsciously recognized him from Super Friends.
Yeah. No, although I did follow him later on Too Close for Comfort.
Jim J. Bullock's finest. Mm-hmm.
Monroe.
Yeah, where he was the least believable cartoonist ever.
Right.
He was like a Garfield-style, like Jim Davis cartoon. I'm like, no. But still good.
Yeah, that show, I don't think it holds up.
No.
Mary Tyler Moore does definitely hold up.
Yep.
Too Close for Comfort does not.
I recently rewatched Chuckles Bites the Dust, because that's always seen as like the best episode of Mary Tyler Moore.
All right. Yes.
Because she starts laughing at the funeral after chiding everyone for making jokes.
Yeah, that's a famous one.
And I remember being like, I've seen that, it's funny, it can't be that good. And I rewatched it, I'm like, this is really good. Like, it's just perfect.
It's just perfect.
It's great.
Well, she was a genius.
Yeah, absolutely.
She really was.
Just, and unheralded too, like even, much like Lucille Ball was, in addition to being in front of the camera, like MTM Productions, who I think did KRP, mm-hmm. all the shows they produced, Newhart, and just like amazing shows, that was all her production company. Mm-hmm. It was her and Grant Tinker. Like, so, you know.
Yeah. And they all seem to have a kind of female character on it that was, that sort of shattered the Leave It to Beaver stereotype of what
the pearls in vacuuming
female, what a wife and mom sort of stay-at-home mom was supposed to be.
Yeah, I mean, she was a single. I think she was divorced, or she got out of an engagement or something in the first episode. But one of the things that struck me was like her relationship with like Phyllis and Rhoda was mm-hmm. so natural and seemed like female friends that would talk. It wasn't just like, oh, Fred's not like he normally is, like women talking about how to get ringer on the collar out or something. Mm-hmm. It was like, no, this is like, you know, 30, almost 30-ish women mm-hmm. just kind of talking about life. And it seems kind of natural and realistic. And I loved Rhoda too. Like, that show was great.
Rhoda was great.
Phyllis, I couldn't really get into, even though I like Cloris Leachman. But
Cloris Leachman? You can't argue with Cloris Leachman, but...
Is there a show that you think of as a quintessential Chicago show?
Chicago
show. Or like
show.
Feels like the world you grew up in?
The world I grew up in. I would have to bring it back to KRP, even though that didn't embody, obviously it didn't take place in a suburban homestead. Like,
right.
But I was obsessed with music from a young age,
right.
And so to me, the fact that music particularly rock music and the kind of revolutionary nature of bringing rock music into their changing the format,
yeah,
and that being something that was driven by this genuine inspired passion,
yep,
was something that I loved, because from the time I was 8 years old, I think I knew music was all I was ever right. going to do with my life.
Right.
And so that show was more meaningful to me than...
It was like a natural culture clash as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because that yeah. really was happening. Like, you were getting all these stations yeah. changing format.
Oh, and since we've looped it back to talking about KRP still, yeah. I had an observation this time that I watched through the first season. This is something I did not pick up on when I was watching it originally. But the character of... Mama,
yeah,
was different on the pilot
yep.
than it was, and when I watched the pilot again, I was like, oh, that's Sylvia Sidney,
yeah,
who I in, you know, more as an adult, I became aware of her work, and just she was really just such a beauty,
yeah,
just such a striking, she was in some movie with Spencer Tracy.
Oh, I know the one you're talking about.
It's like directed by Fritz Lang, I think.
Yep. It's, I can't think of the movie now.
Yeah, and it was about like, he gets like falsely accused of something. Anyway, she yeah. was his fiance in that movie. And
yeah,
she
yeah.
was just like, I was so, wow, that's like the most beautiful woman. Yeah. Look at her eyes.
Yeah, and now she's Mama.
Yeah, and then she shows up later, and for whatever reason, she didn't. She still was very striking as an older woman, although she wasn't beautiful anymore. She
right.
sort of looked like
she's a little harsher.
Like almost like in a Betty Davis kind of a way, where
yeah.
like those eyes, those big eyes, with age sort of became more eerie.
Right, like Maureen O'Hara was like that as well, I think. Like she
yeah.
was, yeah,
yeah. But like, you know, I'm like, Sylvia Sidney shows up in the first episode. I'm like, this is awesome.
Yeah,
I was watching this show for all that time, and I didn't know that this wonderful, beautiful actress played that character,
yeah.
and then she wasn't there anymore
yeah.
after the first.
Like, oh,
like,
that doesn't work. Yeah,
and the woman that they got to replace her was fine, but she just wasn't. She was
she's
no
not Sylvia
Sidney.
Yeah, or even what struck me whenever we watched it is Lonnie Anderson's character.
Mm-hmm.
She runs the station.
Yeah,
she's the boss there. Like, unofficially.
Yes.
And when you think about it, having seen it as a kid, you're like, oh, the dumb, hot, blonde lady. But then you're like, oh, no.
Again,
no.
if we're noticing that this is a show that that Mary Tyler Moore was sort of behind that and producing it.
Yeah.
Look at both of the female characters on KRP. The seemingly dumb blonde who
yep.
actually is running the ship
yep.
and is using... using her beauty and knowing the power that it has over men and like wielding that in a really savvy way.
Yeah.
And in a way which actually is not demeaning to her.
Right.
Is really impressive. But then you've got the Bailey character.
Right.
Who just is, I think her character is single, right?
Yeah.
So she
yeah.
But she's just a smart, endearing, capable.
She's not a lonely, like, well, if you take your glasses off and let your hair down, you'll be beautiful, like, which could have been the cliche for that character.
Right.
And they didn't go that way.
Right.
And that's really weird for that. That's weird for now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you almost don't see that in stuff now.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a show that is worth revisiting. And the Shout Factory box set is great because they got most of the music rights, too.
Oh, great.
Because they released the first season on DVD initially with all music replacement. And it's just weird.
Yeah.
It's like, you feel like you're having a stroke or something. You're like, no, this isn't, I think I know that song, but it's like,
yeah.
it's bizarre.
Yeah.
And then Doctor Who, again, one of the first people to mention Doctor Who on the show, which is shocking to me.
Well, we were, my brothers and I were very into Doctor Who during the Tom Baker era.
Yeah, which was the biggest PBS one. Like, PBS seemed to only ever air the Tom
mm-hmm.
Baker stuff.
And then... when they changed it to whoever the next guy
Peter
was.
Peter Davidson was next.
We just sort of, we were so attached to Tom Baker as
yeah.
a persona that we couldn't take the ride anymore and we gave up on it. The new version of it is kind of cool.
Yeah.
My son was watching that and I sat down and watched a couple episodes with him. I was like, this is pretty cool. Let me show you the old one.
Yeah.
And then we revisited it. And in comparison, it just seemed so...
clunky.
Clunky and dated and slow, and he just wasn't grabbing onto it. And I was like, yeah, but...
It's great, though.
Look at the scarf and the curly hair.
And he's such a weirdo.
He's such a weirdo. It's
and kind of unnerving, too, because you're like, he seems crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he might do something crazy.
Right.
Again, both to those sort of anarchic characters who are like, kind of like, I know those are the rules, but no. I'm doing it this way. And he was the doctor that was the most like that to me.
Right.
Whereas, like, he had a plan, but he's out of his mind. And that was, he was the first one.
And again, if you compare the new version of Doctor Who to the old, there's something about the pacing. Like, our whole, the entertainment in our society as a whole has taken on this frenetic, like...
post-MTV.
Post-MTV, kind of short attention span. It reminds me of something I heard. I'm a big enough nerd about things to where I watched the movie Straight Time with Dustin Hoffman.
Yeah.
I watched it with the full-length commentary.
Oh, I do that all the time. Yeah.
And there was the director, Ulu Grosbard, was talking about... it was the part where they had that scene, if you remember the movie. Do you remember it?
Yep.
Okay, there's a scene around the dinner table where it's Dustin Hoffman, Gary Busey, Kathy Bates, and Gary Busey's real-life son, who was playing his
Jake,
son in in the movie. They just had this scene, this, I don't know, somewhere between 5 and 10 minute long scene that really was just one camera that didn't move and that just showed them interacting.
Yeah.
And so the director is talking about this, you just, about how you don't see anything like that anymore.
No.
And he made this observation about it that I thought was kind of stunning. He's like, I don't think directors nowadays, they don't trust what's happening in front of the camera.
Yeah.
They don't have confidence that what you're seeing there is interesting enough to hold people's attention.
We got to throw a bunch of lights and crazy stuff.
They think that you as a director have to help hold people's attention by cutting and moving and always having music in it.
But that takes you out of things.
That takes
me
you
out of
out
things.
Things. Like, but you can watch that scene where they're all sitting around that table. You can watch that scene, how many people are sitting around the table? 4 people?
Yeah.
You could watch it 4 times in a row, and each time pay attention to what each of the characters are doing.
Yeah.
And how they're responding to
and
what...
And it's more interesting each time.
It's more interesting. And then you see it as this tapestry. And it's not... Nowadays, it's not only the pace of things. It's that what the thing that they want to show you...
Yeah.
They focus on that thing.
They telegraph it so much. They don't give you options.
Right.
Yeah.
So you can't be like if the main character is talking, you don't have the option of looking over their shoulder and seeing how somebody is reacting to
that. Right. Right.
It's just not designed for that.
Yeah,
and I think is it a response to people getting stupider, or is it something that's making people stupider? I'm convinced that we as a society are getting stupider.
Yeah, I think it feeds on itself.
Mm-hmm.
I think that you have sort of cynical people that create stuff for dumb people, and then that makes people dumber, and then those dumb people then create stuff for other dumb people,
mm-hmm.
and it just keeps going. You know, it becomes a copy of a copy of a copy, and which is why our cultural cycle has shrunk to the point where, you know, when we were growing up, we were watching all these old shows and stuff, partly because they were cheap and they would air them, but we had kind of a working knowledge of popular culture 50 years before we were born, from music and comedy and horror and all that stuff, because it was in the, like, if they made a reference in Looney Tunes or on SNL, we'd probably get it,
mm-hmm.
even if it was a reference for something from the 50s.
Yeah.
But now they don't show anything that's more than 10 years old. And, you know, Nick at Night is reruns from shows from 5 years ago or so. You know, so there's like this weird shallowness to the depth of reference, and it's bizarre.
Sad.
But when I watch a show like Barney Miller, it's 5 guys in a room talking for a half an hour
mm-hmm.
every week for 200 episodes
yeah.
doing paperwork. It's a cop show. There's never any action. And it's perfect.
And none of those guys on that show, with I guess the possible exception of Hal Linden, had any sex appeal whatsoever.
None. No. It was schlubby, like just guys that look like cops, you know?
Guys that look like real cops.
But it's hilarious in a lean-in show. Like that's like that.
Guys who would never get a job on TV today.
No, they're not like, hey, I'm a run dashing, you know, whatever. They would never do it. And they just got the best guys. And like with the old Doctor Who, one of the things that took me out of the new one is the stakes are too high every season. They're like, we had to recreate the world from start, and you know, all of humanity was wiped out every episode. And I'm like, I just want killer plants this week. Like, I want the, you know, the Green Death or whatever it was. Like, it kind of misses that peril of low stakes peril. So yeah, I will revisit those, but it is a totally different show. I don't think I've met anyone who came into Doctor Who from the new one, who's younger than me, who went back and checked out the old one and liked it. Like, there are other people who are like, oh, I got to check this out. And they're like, what is this?
Yeah.
I guess it's like if you...
I don't know. Maybe you had to be 12.
Maybe. But I guess it's like really like in a rock band and going back and putting something on and it sounds like, you know, like Tin Pan, like, hello, my baby. And you're like, what is this? This is not what I... Yeah.
And it's like, it's funny because I remember watching it and not thinking that it was schmaltzy. It seemed contemporary.
It was. I mean,
but somehow, then we've lived to the point where that... where it seems really dated, and yet somehow in my psyche I can connect to it not being dated at all.
Well, because it was experience. I mean, pre-Star Wars, people were more willing to, you know, watching sci-fi stuff. Like, I feel like it was more like watching a play. Yeah. Like, if you watch a play now, you just need the sort of sense of what's going on. You know, like, it doesn't look like a real house.
Right.
Like, but people would watch TV like that. Like, you would fill in those gaps, and now people have this expectation of, like... their suspension of disbelief bar is a lot lower. And it's, you know, and I think that probably is part of people being dumber a lot of ways. MASH you put on there, which is a show that was always too old for me. It was
My dad liked that show a lot. And so he was, it's funny, I would never intentionally turn on MASH. And yet I ended up watching it almost every day because my dad liked it.
Yeah, did you have one TV in the house?
There was one color TV downstairs, a big one.
The good TV?
The good TV. And then there was like a tiny little black and white one upstairs. But you didn't want to spend any time with that. But again, on MASH, I resonated with the Hawkeye character because he was so countercultural and giving the finger to the man all the time. And
being like ridiculously subversive in the middle of the most sort of conservative kind of thing. You know, you're at war. And the way that show got away with making a show about Vietnam that wasn't about Vietnam during Vietnam is nuts. Like, I can't imagine people being able to do that now with, like, current state stuff. Like, make a comedy show that's about Iraq.
Right.
But that's what it was. No one would stay. Like, people would lose their minds. There'd be outrage everywhere. And it's like, but why? You know, like... people, that's why we have humor. It's gallows humor, you know? It's the people who make the most jokes are those guys in those kind of situations.
Yeah. Although, as a kid, I'm watching that show completely disconnected from, like, what that war meant politically and whether or not we agree with the war or, you know, think that we never should have been there.
Right, right. But you can enjoy it on that level, or the other, like,
you can.
It's a great
but as a kid, I was just like, these people are in the military and they're doctors.
He's wearing a dress.
And it's funny, and you know, this Hawkeye character just seemed like one of these guys who cynically saw through everything.
Yep, reads a lot, just like knows that, you know, like almost like a super beatnik.
Because
they were always seemed like slightly more intellectual than hippies. He was like, I read books. I know what you're trying to do.
Yeah.
And it was almost the thrill that I would get watching those detective series when the detective's like, I knew the whole time. Because we all, like, as kids, like, that's who you wanted to be. That guy who knew what was going on.
Yep.
But didn't want to say anything yet. He was just going to let people kind of simmer in it. And that was the best.
Definitely.
And then you immediately saw... the movie What's New Pussycat, and we're like, wow.
Yeah, and I had to ask permission whether we're just supposed to talk about TV shows, but I noticed there on Sunday, October 21st, 1979, at 4 p.m., Channel 56, they were showing What's New Pussycat, which is a wonderful fun, kind of magical, farcical comedy with, again, a central character who is like, Peter O'Toole is like kind of a beatnik in his own way. But his thing is he just, he channels it all into womanizing.
Right.
So he has this series of absolutely beautiful women that he's involved with.
So it's like an intellectual chess game aspect to him.
And the, you know, it's a movie that the script is, the movie ended up being a bastardized version of a script that was written by Woody Allen.
Oh, okay.
And Woody Allen has a small role in the movie.
Okay.
It's like, it was one of his first movies, so it wasn't like a Woody Allen movie.
Right.
He was like, you know, some of the studio people got involved and sort of made it more madcap
or whatever.
As they
always do, yeah.
Yeah, but it's a great movie.
But that speaks to, I mean, like, pre-video stores,
mm-hmm.
that's where a lot of us saw movies.
Yeah.
It was, you know, and because if you saw a movie in the theater, you, as far as you knew, were never going to see that movie again.
Oh, yeah. No, but I didn't see that one in the theater.
Yeah.
Saw it on TV, taped it. So I have this this VHS tape with What's New Pussycat on it.
Right.
Used to watch that a lot. And I don't know what band did that song. Not that I know, it was Tom Jones did the theme song.
Right.
But then in the middle of the movie, there's that song that goes...
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah.
All I do is talk about her, hear her name, and I start to cry. There's just no getting over you. And this is a scene where Peter Sellers and Peter O'Toole are like at a nightclub dancing to that song.
Swinging 60s.
And Peter O'Toole is doing this crazy like...
shimmy?
Shimmy. And he just looks so awesome. And I'm like, I want to be Peter O'Toole.
Have you ever seen The Love God with Don Knotts?
With Don Knotts, yes.
For some reason, that's what I was thinking of. I haven't
seen it. That's a great
but
movie.
But that is another movie that I'm like...
The one and only
is
Don
so
Knotts.
So funny. And it's that's a movie that you could remake today without changing a thing, and it would seem completely contemporary.
Because mm-hmm.
it's just that well written. And Nat Hiken, who did the Phil Silver Show in Car 54, and was so ahead of his time with the structure and stuff that he did. He died before that movie came out and never made another movie or wrote anything else. Nat Hiken, who wrote and directed The Love God. And he created...
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was like this genius of a guy. And he had a heart attack and died before the movie came out.
Oh, wow.
And it's one of the ones that really makes me sad because I'm like, I would have loved to have seen the movies that guy made.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it would have just been unbelievable. Because when I watch, like, Car 54, it's Curb Your Enthusiasm. It's Seinfeld. It's that series of interconnected misunderstandings that builds and builds and builds this beautiful crescendo. And it's complicated, but it makes sense. Like, there's an episode of Phil Silver's where a monkey enlists in the army.
Okay.
And it somehow makes sense. Like, he writes it in a way where it's plausible,
mm-hmm.
which is so hard to pull that kind of thing off.
Yeah.
And it's amazing. Do you have a favorite TV theme song as a musician?
Yes. I think that the greatest TV theme song of all time, and this doesn't mean that it was the greatest show of all time.
Right,
I don't think it was.
Oh, no, you separate the theme from the show.
But I think Welcome Back, Cotter is the greatest TV. That song stands up on its own.
Yep.
You put it on, you listen to it, and you're like, wow, what a great vibe, what a great groove.
And a sad, sad song,
it's kind of sad.
But charted. I mean, that was the age when
the
theme songs from shows charted all the time.
And, like, I love... say, like, you know, the theme from WKRP. But WKRP, the theme, at least the opening theme, is a little schmaltzy, and you have to love the show in order to love the theme song.
It sounds like the Love Boat theme a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Their closing theme is just amazing, with the gibberish and the...
Yep.
It just rocks. But but no, it would have to be Welcome Back, Cotter.
Yeah. A show that I, again, don't like, but love that theme.
Yeah. I recently kind of rewatched it. It doesn't stand up as
it's
much
real
as
bad.
You want it to.
It's real bad.
But I did, at a kind of recent show, I was playing TV theme songs in between songs just to sort of entertain people. And I said, this is the greatest TV theme song of all time. I started playing Welcome Back, Cotter, and nobody knew it. I was getting blank stares.
Yeah.
So then during the next song break, I said, okay, we'll try this one. Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got. Yeah. And everybody starts singing along. Yeah. And like the whole place is just, wouldn't you like to get away?
But it's all that like minor key melancholy-ish.
Yeah, which also, maybe that's the second greatest theme song. And that show actually is really good.
Yeah. And that theme song's perfect in tone for the show.
Yep.
Because it's a sad show about lonely people. I had Ted Danson on. Yes. And he was talking about, and this, he said, Sam wasn't cool. He was alone and sad and alcoholic. And he goes, the way I played him was when I read that his name was Sam Malone. I went, he's always Sam Alone. He's always going to be alone. And that's how I'm playing him. Yeah. And I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. You know, and that theme song sounds like that to me because it's that really.
Yeah.
And, you know, you got, like, Taxi, which had that really creepy kind
of... I liked a lot of those instrumental themes.
Yeah.
Taxi, Barney Miller.
Yep.
Oh, like, when I was sort of figuring out how to play guitar, I learned the guitar solo to the Barney Miller theme song. And would just play that. That was part of, like... you probably even today, if you pay attention to like some of the licks I'm playing on guitar, you can hear some Barney Miller.
It's all Barney Miller.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it was one of the few things where it was like, this was a song you were going to hear every week.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you didn't own records and stuff, you're younger, but you're hearing that song every week. So like a lot of people I know, their first favorite song is the TV theme song because they go like, they heard it every week. You know, it was always consistently there. And Barney Miller has that weird drumming. It's like in a weird time too, because it's like... It's like in a really weird,
real funky.
Yeah, it's very 70s.
I also loved the theme song to Soap.
Yeah.
Although I bring this show up to a lot of people and they never even heard of it.
That's bizarre.
Most
actually with the narration. It was very like game show. Yeah.
But it had those kind of jazzy chord changes that were a little counterintuitive.
Yep.
And
but most people know Benson, which was a spinoff of Soap, more than they remember Soap.
Right.
I've found, at least, weirdly. And Soap had the first gay character on a show. It was Billy Crystal.
Billy Crystal.
But it was really cartoonish and silly.
Mm-hmm.
And then they cured him and stuff. But it was still, like, you know, this is a mainstream show.
Yeah. I just remember the episodes where the baby was possessed.
Yes. Yes. Which, that's a show that's hard to show people now because the context of that was the shows that was parodying were really doing plots like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that wasn't even an exaggeration because Rosemary's Baby and The Exorcist were very popular. So they would just absorb that on those daily soaps because they're like, I don't know, I got to write 5 of these a week.
Oh, man.
It was UFOs and whatever. So it's like a lot of people I know rewatched Twin Peaks recently because the new one came out. And there's that that soap that runs in.
Can we talk about this?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, the original series of Twin Peaks, I felt, and I guess still feel, is some of the best television ever made.
Yeah,
it might be at the top of my list.
I agree, yeah.
At least the first season and a half until they resolved the original mystery.
Until Wyndham Earle came in and the whole...
Yeah, yeah. But like... You know, up until you know, the point where you find out who killed Laura Palmer and then that storyline is resolved over the next couple episodes. If you take that as a miniseries, potentially the best TV ever made.
Yep.
So I'm looking forward with great anticipation to the new series and then found it to be...
Enraging?
Enraging.
Yep. Yeah.
That's the word I'm looking for.
Yep.
I took it as a personal affront.
Yep, that's the reaction. A friend of mine is a great writer, and he summed it up, because I actually ended up really liking it, and he did as well, but he said, you know, especially the finale and the new season, the reaction wasn't new. It was how I remember people reacting to the end of the original series, which was outrage, followed by contemplation, acceptance, and then affinity. Like, once people were like, wait a minute.
I'm stuck at the outrage.
I think you're stuck at outrage, and a lot of people are.
Because my feeling about it is that I'm disappointed in David Lynch. I don't know the man, so I am only speculating as to what is driving him to make the choices that he makes.
Yeah.
But my sort of gut feeling about it is that he had to be kind of afraid or insecure about actually trying to remake the show.
It's weird for weird's sake too much sometimes.
To him, it was, it seemed safer.
Yep.
To be, oh, look how weird I am now.
Yeah.
Look how much I've progressed as an artist where I can make something that's 10 times as weird as Twin Peaks.
Right.
But it's actually a safer move because I don't have to try to get back to a place and fail to get there.
Right. And I'm not risking people being angry at the plot resolution because there isn't one.
Right.
And I took the final two episodes as...
I watched the first three episodes, and it was making me so angry.
It gets better.
I canceled my subscription to Showtime.
Wow.
Unfollowed David Lynch on Twitter and decided I'm done with him as an artist. That's how much I hated that show.
Yeah. It gets better. And to what you were talking about earlier about the slowness, mm-hmm. I actually really loved how slow it was.
Yeah.
And people were mad about like the Dougie thing where Coop comes back, but it went on really long.
I could have put up with all of that.
Yeah. If you got a resolution.
No. The thing that was missing from the show was all of the endearing warmth and humor of the original series was gone. Not a trace of it.
It's harsher. It's when you...
It's harsh.
By expanding the world and having New York and Las Vegas and stuff, it doesn't have that small town.
The first series took place only in Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
So that the town of Twin Peaks was like a character in itself.
Right.
And here, you're jumping all over to different cities, and so that takes you... It ruins the...
That dream logic and that sort of... Yeah, like... I actually really loved... We always had these waves of when a show was popular, you'd get all these shows greenlit in the wake of it.
Mm-hmm.
And Twin Peaks was so hugely popular for a season.
Yeah.
And then it was gone. But we got Picket Fences, and we got Northern Exposure, mm-hmm. and we got all these odd shows that also had that interesting kind of weird world after. And I've chosen to revisit a lot of those after the new Twin Peaks because... Mm-hmm. A friend of mine is a comics in the new Twin Peaks. He plays the limo driver that drives Dougie home.
Okay.
And I just had him on the show, and he was saying that... And he also doesn't know who David Lynch is.
Yeah.
And he was like... So the direction David Lynch gave them, he goes, okay, Jay, you're going to get out of the car, and you will hear an owl. I will be the owl. And then he will fall. So he's just like, it doesn't make any sense. And I think, I wonder how much of him is that playing dumb, aw shucks, I'm kind of a nut, but I know exactly what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And how much is just like he's been being David Lynch so long that he can't not do that.
Yeah.
And he's just making moving paintings. I don't know.
I feel like, when he did the original series, he was David Lynch, but again, these are assumptions about what's going on with him as a person. But like, I feel like, so he's a nut. He's off the beaten path.
Yeah.
But this was a prime time network show, and so he's
gonna play in those roles.
He had a shot at the big time, and he could be freaky David Lynch guy, but then also have mainstream success.
Right.
Which he had for a season and a half.
Yeah.
Until they told you who really killed Laura Palmer.
Right.
And then I feel like what happened to his career after that is that he found that he had much more success and felt more at home not even trying to have mainstream success.
Yeah.
Like, he could play into this weird for weird's sake thing.
You can't handle it.
And the freakier he got, the more his cultish fan base was like, ooh, I love it. And they just kept eating it up. And so he's like, all right, I'm just going to go completely off the rails.
I'm going to stop trying to cultivate new people and just really pump up the people
already
there.
I was so hoping that in the new version of the show that Mark Frost's influence would put the thing back on the rails and keep a storyline and keep some like character development going and that sense of writing for television that he brought to the original. He would bring that, but he apparently...
Well, I think one of the things that hurt him was that it was on Showtime, so they didn't have any constraints.
Yeah.
They let them do whatever they wanted.
Lynch's best work is always with constraints.
Yep.
Whether it's The Elephant Man, The Straight Story,
I love The Straight Story.
By that time, I mean, he had freedom to do things, but he was making that movie for Disney.
Yeah.
He was
It's a G-rated movie.
Yeah, he was basing it on a true story, so there's constraints to the story.
That's such a sweet movie, too. It really
is great.
It's maybe his best movie, I think.
Well, that's a tough one, because The Elephant Man is... a perfect movie.
It is, but I don't...
And
I
it's
don't,
perhaps the saddest, most touching film
That's what
ever
I was
going to
say. I don't revisit it often because it's so,
heavy. So
sad.
It's so heavy.
Yeah. And Straight Story's heavy, but it's more... There's more of a redemption plot in it. And Elephant Man is just kind of like...
Yeah,
people
you don't
are
rewatch
the worst.
Elephant Man every
yeah,
year, but...
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, Museum of the Moving Image has the original Elephant Man makeup, by the way.
Wow.
It has the... Because they have a makeup exhibit. Yeah. And they have John Hurt's makeup from the Elephant Man. Just in a case.
Wow.
It's cool. And if you're a Blade Runner fan, they have the miniature of Terrell Industries that they used in the movie.
Okay.
Like that shot with the weird like tower with all the lights. And they just have it.
I just saw the new one. I was never a big fan of the old Blade Runner.
Yeah.
The new one's really cool, though.
I heard that. It's still slow. Like, the pace is much more like the old one, yeah.
But it was directed by the same guy that did, I think he did Sicario?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's a great director, and he did, like, that one with Amy Adams and the aliens, Arrival.
Oh, yes, yep.
Or Arriving, or whatever it's called. Yeah.
Well, she's the linguist, and yeah.
So his, visually, and the pacing, and you know, look-wise, cinematography-wise, his movies are beautiful.
Yeah.
He did a fantastic job with the new Blade
Runner. I
gotta
see it. It's still, it's like, I have to see it before it gets out of the theaters because I want to see it on the big screen. Is there anything you watch now to wrap up? Is there anything that you love that's new or contemporary? Or?
I don't watch contemporary stuff really, except Better Call Saul.
Okay. Did you watch Breaking Bad as well? And
yeah. Enjoyed Breaking Bad, but Better Call Saul is a better show.
Yeah. That's what I've heard as
it
well.
It is Yeah, you haven't seen it?
I've never even seen Breaking Bad.
Oh, well, you can just watch Better Call Saul. It makes sense.
You don't have to watch.
Breaking
so maybe
Bad.
I'll just skip to that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I've heard it's great, and I love the cast, and Odenkirk's great,
oh, it's
and everything.
Amazing. And I never realized. I mean, I've always been a fan of Michael McKean's work.
Yeah.
But I never realized how much of a powerhouse dramatic actor he is.
Yeah. He did.
This is a performance of a lifetime that he gives on this.
He's completely underrated in all ways. Like he did an episode of Laverne and Shirley that they. Yeah. It's a Christmas episode, and it's that classic cliche thing like we have to put on a show for Christmas. Yeah. They're in a prison, and so Lenny and Squiggy do music, but Michael McKean plays an original song called "The Jolly Old Fat Man." That's this like really sad. Great, funny, but kind of twisted original Christmas song.
Yeah,
and he's not being, you know, Lenny. He's being Michael McKean in this moment. And it's, I love that they let him do it on the show.
Yeah.
And I'm like, he's so great in like everything. Is there anything you've shown your kids that they did like something from your youth that you're like, you're gonna love this, and they actually did lock onto it?
The shows that my kids really liked a lot were the Andy Griffith Show.
Yep.
And the Dick Van Dyke Show.
That's interesting. So the black and white didn't turn them off?
No. They like it. Oh, and my daughter really likes the Twilight Zone.
Wow. That's interesting. That's another show that I feel like made a generation of people better people.
Mm-hmm.
Because the allegory in that show.
Yeah.
There's so many, when I've had like, this will make it sound more heavy than it is, but when I've had like moral choice, like moral crossroads in my life, like even minor ones. There's very few that episodes of Twilight Zone haven't flashed through where I'm like, oh, right, nope, to like influence my decision, you know.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And I can't think of other shows that have done that, you know, where it's just like,
I guess I think about that too. As kind of an introverted person myself, I sometimes think, you know, life would be better if I could just be alone all the time.
Right.
If all these other people would go away.
But then I'm if it last.
Then I'm reminded of that one with Burgess Meredith where he has time with his books and then his
glasses
break.
Time enough at last. Yes.
Time enough at last.
And he's all excited. And it's and that one is atypical to Twilight Zone too, because he's not a cruel person, but he's punished in one of the most cruel ways that they ever did that to any character on that show.
Right.
And it's...
But he's punished... not that he's cruel, but his character doesn't love people.
No, no.
He's a misanthrope.
It's a careful what you wish for.
Yeah.
But it's still like, it's a comeuppance that's almost just too cruel for the message, because it's or maybe that's just hard, because it's so, like, everyone remembers how horrible that is.
You remember the episode that Robert Duval was on?
Yes. Yeah.
And it's the little dollhouse and...
Yeah. It's
an early Duval. Interesting, even back then, you see, I mean, he's arguably the greatest actor of all time.
Is that where I assume that's where you got the name for Duval?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, him and Brando.
Yeah.
Are like, I think they're in a cage match for the greatest actor of all time. But
have you seen Lost Souls, by the way, the documentary about the Island of Dr. Moreau with Brando?
No.
It's unbelievably good because Brando, it's completely out of his mind, and Richard Stanley, the director, got fired, ran into the woods, disappeared, came back on the set as a cat man undercover to try to sabotage the movie.
Really?
It's a documentary, and all the stuff about Brando, because he's like full on, like he's a guy that I just think wanted people to tell him no, like he's constantly pushing, and no one ever did, and that's one of the examples. He's like, I think my character should have ice bucket on his head, and they're like, okay.
Wow.
Just everything. But sorry, I interrupted. Yeah, but him and Cary Elwes I had on, and he went from Princess Bride.
Yeah.
And when he was 19, he was Marlon Brando's assistant on Superman, and he was working at Shepperton Studios, and Brando had a contract that was for 3 days, and then he had overages of $10,000 a day that they went over, so he wouldn't come out of his trailer because he's making $10,000 a day that they went over. So it was Carrie's job to get him out of the trailer. So the first day, they're like, Mr. Brando, this is Carrie's going to be helping. He goes, what's your name? He goes, Cary goes, no, it isn't. Name's Rocco. And he's like, okay. So he's calling him Rocco. So he would give him these weird tasks before he would come out. Now, keep in mind, he's in that spit curl Superman outfit while this is happening, which is funnier. Mm-hmm. So one day he's like, I want a lemon meringue pie. So he's in England in Shepperton Studios. It's like 5 o'clock. So he gets him a little lemon curd, and he goes, what's that? He goes, oh, it's a lemon curd. He's like, lemon turds? You eat it, Rocky. And he'd make him eat stuff, and then he'd be like, okay, I'll go to the set now. Just this weird stuff.
What a fascinating guy.
Yeah. Yeah. Duval, I haven't heard stories like that. Like,
no,
he just
Duval
seems
like more of a quality.
Yeah.
Guy who's a little more grounded to planet Earth, even though he has a otherworldly level of talent.
Yeah, yeah.
On that episode, like you over the years, you've seen just the range of emotion and power, and even like the intellectual subtlety that that Duval can bring to a role. But in that episode, he kind of makes himself sort of blank.
Yeah.
And it's interesting.
It's been great talking to you. Thank you for doing this.
I've really enjoyed this conversation. Thanks for having me on the podcast.
You're very welcome. Thank you. How great is Josh? What a nice guy. Fascinating guy. Insightful. Really love talking to him. And as I said, his music is unbelievably good. Far better than my music was when I was in a punk band in the 90s. But, you know, I'm not a musician. I'm, I guess, a podcaster, comedian, and a man. That's all I am. I'm just a man. If you want to contribute to this podcast, by the way, if you enjoyed it, you can go on Patreon. Just search TV Guidance Counselor. I started that so that the show can remain ad-free. There weren't really any products that I wanted to put on the show, and I felt weird about having ads. It's that DIY punk rock kid in me. So if you want to donate $1 a month or $100 a month or $10,000 a month or nothing, you can do that. If you want to buy TV Guidance Counselor merchandise, that helps the show. You can go on iCanRead.com. We got t-shirts, buttons, sleeping bags, all kinds of stuff. If you want to get something cool for yourself and throw a couple bucks towards the show, helps cover my costs for web hosting, travel, lunch for guests, you know, just minimal stuff, which I don't mind paying for, but any little bit helps. It's totally cool if you don't feel like doing that as well. If you enjoyed the show, though, please rate and review the show. If you got this on iTunes or Google Play or Stitcher, you want to rate the show, give us a review. I always read them. I very much appreciate you taking time to do that. You can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com. Icanread.com being my stand-up comedy page and where you can get TV Guidance Counselor merchandise. We have brand new shows each and every Wednesday, but sometimes I have bonus episodes, so be sure to subscribe to the show. And you can also go on Facebook, just search TV Guidance Counselor, or tweet to me at TV Guidance, or you don't have to do any of that. You can just be here next week for our brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
And none of those guys on that show, with I guess the possible exception of Hal Linden, had any sex appeal whatsoever.
None.
All I do is talk about her, hear her name, and I start to cry. There's just no getting over you.